Steve Biko, I Write What I Like, a selection of his writings edited with a personal memoir by Elred Stubbs. Copyright 1978. Preface. The time for a comprehensive biography of Steve Biko is not yet, but it is hoped that the production of a book containing a selection of his writings together with a personal memoir may be timely, that it may serve to inform those who all over the world know the name Biko only in the dreadful context of his death a little more fully what manner of man he was. For this reason, nothing is said in depth about his death, crucial as this is in a final assessment of the man. I am acutely aware that the definitive writing on Steve can only come from one who writes from within his own tradition, historic, linguistic, and political. Unfortunately, at the moment, those who are so qualified are either in detention, banned, on Robben Island, or in exile. I can claim to have known him from the mid-1960s, and with a deepening intimacy, as the memoir indicates, from 1973 until his death. I am a priest of the Anglican Community of the Resurrection. Our headquarters is at Murfield in Yorkshire. We have worked in South Africa since 1903. I was sent out in 1959 to join the staff of St. Peter's Theological College, Rosettenville, Johannesburg, of which I became principal in 1960. Forced by government legislation to close at Rosettenville in 1963, we took St. Peter's to form the Anglican Constituent College in the new Ecumenical Federal Theological Seminary at Alice, next to Fort Hare. I was expelled from the Republic in July 1977. The compilation of this book would have been impossible but for a generous grant from World University Service, an organization devoted, amongst other excellent aims, to the service of Steve's cause. Even then, because of my inability to enter South Africa, the material could not have been collected but for the initiative, diligence, and skill of Mr. David Messenbring. He has also read through the manuscript of the memoir and made valuable criticisms. To them, I express my grateful thanks, as also to a sister who typed the manuscript of the memoir, and to the librarian and staff of the National University of Lesotho. Much of the material here gathered together was supplied from sources who do not wish for public acknowledgement, but I am nevertheless grateful for their cooperation. Thanks are due to the editors and publishers of the articles contained in chapters 11, 14, 18, and 19, and for permission to reproduce them. The royalties from this book will go to the Biko family, to be devoted by them to a project of which they know Steve would have approved. Elred Stubbs, C.R., Masit, Lesotho, 1978. Chapter 1, Introduction. Stephen Bantu Biko was born in King Williamstown, Cape Province, on 18 December 1946, the third child and second son of Mr. and Mrs. Zimgaye Biko. His father died when Stephen was 4. He received primary and secondary education locally before proceeding to Lovedale Institution, Alice. He did not stay long at that Bantu Education Department run school, however, and his formative higher schooling was received at the Roman Catholic Marion Hill in Natal. Matriculating at the end of 1965, he entered the medical school of the White University of Natal, non-European section, Durban, at the beginning of 1966. Active at first in NUSAS, National Union of South African Students, He broke with them in 1968 to form SASO, South African Students Organization, of which he was elected first president in July 1969, and in July 1970 he was appointed publicity secretary. In December 1970 he married Miss Nantsikelelo Nitsiki Mashalaba from Umtata. From 1971 his heart was increasingly in political activity, and in the middle of 1972 his course at Wentworth was terminated. Immediately he began to work for BCP, Black Community Programs, in Durban. But at the beginning of March 1973, together with seven other SASO leaders, was banned. Restricted to his home of Kings Williamstown, he founded the Eastern Cape branch of BCP and worked as a branch executive until an extra clause was inserted in his banning order at the end of 1975, prohibiting him from working for BCP. In 1975, he was instrumental in founding the Zimele Trust Fund. He was detained for 101 days under Section 6 of the Terrorism Act from August to December 1976, and was then released without being charged. He was many times charged under security legislation, but never convicted. In January 1977, he was appointed honorary president of BPC, Black People's Convention, for 5 years, an organization he helped found in 1972. On August 18, 1977, he was again detained under Section 6 of the Terrorism Act. He was taken to Port Elizabeth, where he was kept naked and manacled, as was revealed at the inquest after his death. He died in detention on September 12th. The cause of death was established as brain damage. His death and the inquest have been so extensively reported that it is unnecessary to add further details here. He leaves a widow and two small boys aged 7 and 3. The writings which follow belong or refer to the period 1969 to 72, when Steve was active in the Black Consciousness Movement, of which he is now regarded as the father. After his banning in March 1973, he could no longer travel, speak in public, or write for publication. It seems logical, therefore, to place these before the memoir, which deals mainly with the period after he was banned. The evidence at the BPC SASO trial in Pretoria was given in the first week of May 1976, but refers to events which took place during the earlier period. Thus, the book follows a chronological sequence as far as can be ascertained. Chapter 2: South African Students Organization, its role, its significance, and its future. In the early 1960s, there had been abortive attempts to found non-white student organizations. In 1961 and 1962, the African Students Association, ASA, and the African Students Union of South Africa, ASUSA, were established. The Durban Students Union and the Cape Peninsular Students Union, which later merged to form the Progressive National Students Organization, were fanatically opposed to NUSAS initially. ASA and ASUSA were divided by ideological loyalties connected with ANC, African National Congress, and Pan-Africanist Congress, PAC. None of these organizations survived. NUSAS was by no means a spent force on the black campuses. But the fact that its own power base was on white campuses, WITS, the University of Witwatersrand, Rhodes, University of Cape Town, Natal, meant that it was virtually impossible for black students to attain leadership positions. Least of all could NUSAS speak for non-white campuses, though it often assumed that role. The formation of the University Christian Movement, UCM, in 1967 gave blacks a greater chance of coming together. Its initial political respectability in the eyes of the black university college authorities gave it a chance to function on those campuses in a way impossible for NUSAS. At the USCM conference at Stutterheim in July 1968, about 40 blacks from all the main black centers of higher education in the Republic formed themselves into a caucus and agreed on the need for a nationally representative black student organization. The UNB group, University of Natal Black, which of course included Steve, was asked to continue investigations. As a result, a representative conference was held at Marion Hill, Natal, in December 1968, when SASO was formed to be officially inaugurated at Turf Loop in July 1969, when Steve was elected president. This is Steve's presidential address to the first National Formation School of SASO, held at University of Natal, Black Section, Wentworth, Durban, December 1st to 4th, 1969. SASO, its role, its significance, and its future. Very few of the South African students' organizations have elicited as mixed a response on their establishment as SASO seems to have done. It would seem that only the middle of the roaders have accepted SASO. Cries of shame were heard from the white students who have struggled for years to maintain interracial contact. From some of the black militants' point of view, SASO was far from the answer. It was still too amorphous to be of any real help. No one was sure of the real direction of SASO. Everybody expressed fears that SASO was a conformist organization. A few of the white students expressed fears that this was a sign to turn towards militancy. In the middle of it all was the SASO executive. Those people were called upon to make countless explanations on what this all was about. I am surprised that this had to be so. Not only was the move taken by the non-white students defensible, but it was a long overdue step. It seems sometimes that it is a crime for the non-white students to think for themselves. The idea of everything being done for the blacks is an old one, and all liberals take pride in it. But once the black students want to do things for themselves, suddenly they are regarded as becoming militant. Probably it would be of use at this stage to paraphrase the aims of SASO as an organization. These are: 1. To crystallize the needs and aspirations of the non-white students and to seek to make known their grievances. 2. Where possible, to put into effect programs designed to meet the needs of the non-white students and to act on a collective basis in an effort to solve some of the problems which beset the centers individually. 3. To heighten the degree of contact not only amongst the non-white students, but also amongst these and the rest of the South African student population to make the non-white students accepted on their own terms as an integral part of the South African student community. 4, to establish a solid identity among the non-white students and to ensure that these students are always treated with the dignity and respect they deserve. 5, to protect the interests of the member centers and to act as a pressure group on all institutions and organizations for the benefit of the non-white students. 6, to boost up the morale of the non-white students, to heighten their own confidence in themselves, and to contribute largely to the direction of thought taken by the various institutions on social, political, and other current topics. The above aims give in a nutshell the role of SASO as an organization. The fact that the whole ideology centers around non-white students as a group might make a few people to believe that the organization is racially inclined. Yet, what SASO has done is simply to take stock of the present scene in the country and to realize that not unless the non-white students decide to lift themselves from the doldrums, will they ever hope to get out of them. What we want is not black visibility, but real black participation. In other words, it does not help us to see several quiet black faces in a multiracial student gathering, which ultimately concentrate on what the white students believe are the needs for the black students. Because of our sheer bargaining power as an organization, we can manage, in fact, to bring about a more meaningful contact between the various color groups in the student world. The idea that SASO is a form of quote-unquote black NUSAS has been thrown around. Let it be known that SASO is not a national union and has never claimed to be one. Neither is SASO opposed to NUSAS as a national union. SASO accepts the principle that in any one country at any time a national union must be open to all students in that country, and in our country, NUSAS is the national union and SASO accepts her fully as such and offers no competition in that direction. What SASO objects to is the dichotomy between principle and practice so apparent among members of that organization. While very few would like to criticize NUSAS policy and principles as they appear on paper, one tends to get worried at all hypocrisy practiced by the members of that organization. This serves to make the non-white members feel unaccepted and insulted in many instances. One may also add that the mere numbers fail to reflect a true picture of the South African scene. There shall always be a white majority in the organization. This in itself does not matter, except that where there is conflict of interest between the two color groups, the non-white always gets off the poorer. These are some of the problems SASO looks into. We would not like to see the black centers being forced out of NUSAS by a swing to the right. Hence, it becomes our concern to exert our influence on NUSAS where possible for the benefit of the non-white centers who are members of that organization. Another popular question is why SASO does not affiliate to NUSAS. SASO has a specific role to play, and it has been set up as the custodian of non-white interest. It can best serve this purpose by maintaining only functional relationships with other student organizations, but not structural ones. It is true that one of the reasons why SASO was formed was that organizations like NUSAS were anathema at the university colleges. Footnote: the quote-unquote university colleges were the ethnic institutions established by the nationalist government, e.g. at Ngoye for the Zulus, Turfloop for the Tswanas, and Sotho. The takeover of the formerly non-ethnic Fort Hare, where many leaders of the independent African countries were educated, for the Hossas, Belleville for the Coloreds, and Duran Westville for the Indian. Editor's note, and a footnote. However, our decision not to affiliate to NUSES arises out of the consideration of our role as an organization in that we do not want to develop any structural relationships that may later interfere with our effectiveness. SASO has met with a number of difficulties shortly after its inception. 1. There is the chronic problem of not having enough financial resources. It does seem that this is where most non-white organizations fail. However, we hope to clear out of this difficulty soon, and we shall, in the process, need lots of help from the stronger centers. 2. Traditional sectionalization still makes correspondence a very sluggish business with some centers. Most of the university colleges have a long history of isolation. Some of them have grabbed the chance to break free from their cocoons. A few still cling tenaciously to them. We have, for instance, been unable to get through to Belleville. We have difficulty in getting to a few other centers, but I am happy to see that most centers realize the exciting possibilities of this meaningful form of communication. We hope in time that we shall all be able to join in the happy community of those who share their problems. 3. The bogey of authority also seems a real problem. Understandably, lots of students are afraid that any involvement with anybody beyond their own university might attract unwarranted attention, not only from local, but also from national authority. However, one hopes that there will be more examples of those courageous few who built up the SRC at places like Turfloop to the point where it had a lot of bargaining power with the rector. 4. Non-acceptance by NUSAS sparked off lots of unwelcome problems. Too many centers accepting SASO became an automatic step towards withdrawing from NUSAS. Very few centers seem to be able to grasp the differences and focal points between the two organizations. 5. There has been considerable lack of support from the various SRCs for those involved in the organization. A lot of people, even from the affiliated centers, seem to regard themselves as observers. However, besides these problems, the executive has continued applying itself diligently towards setting a really solid foundation for the future. There is reason to believe that SASO will grow from strength to strength as more and more centers join. The future of SASO highly depends on a number of things. Personally, I believe that there will be a swing to the right on the white campuses. This will result in the death of NUSAS or a change in that organization that will virtually exclude all non-whites. All sensible people will strive to delay the advent of that moment. I believe that SASO too should. But if the day when it shall come is inevitable, when it does come, SASO will shoulder the full responsibility of being the only student organization catering for the needs of the non-white students. And in all probability, SASO will be the only student organization still concerned about contact between various color groups. Lastly, I wish to call upon all student leaders at the non-white institutions to put their weight solidly behind SASO and to guarantee the continued existence of the organization, not only in name, but also in effectiveness. This is a challenge to test the independence of the non-white student leaders, not only organizationally, but also ideologically. The fact that we have differences of approach should not cloud the issue. We have a responsibility not only to ourselves, but also to the society from which we spring. No one else will ever take the challenge up until we, of our own accord, accept the inevitable fact that ultimately the leadership of the non-white peoples in this country rests with us. Chapter 3, Letter to Students Representative Council Presidents. This chapter consists of a letter sent by Steve as president of SASO in February 1970 to the SRC, Students Representative Council, presidents of English and Afrikaans Medium University, to National Student and other, including overseas organizations. It gives the historical background and an authoritative rationale for the founding of SASO. The tone is conciliatory towards NUSAS, which is still recognized as, quote-unquote, the true national union of students in South Africa today. Steve was aware of the strength of opposition to a segregated body, particularly outside South Africa, which is where it was hoped that some of the money for the support of SASO would come from. It was necessary to present the positive purpose in the formation of SASO, which would make it clear that the quote-unquote withdrawal was only in order to regroup and be more effective in striving toward the common ultimate aim of both NUSAS and SASO, a non-racial egalitarian society. The historical background section displays Steve's strong sense of history and particularly of the continuity of African resistance to the various forms of white oppression. In reading this document, readers should remember that from his first arrival at medical school, Steve had taken a leading part in NUSAS activities and had been an outstandingly successful NUSAS local chairman. It could never be said of him that he turned to founding a rival organization because of his failure to, quote-unquote, make the grade in NUSAS. Also, it is remarkable, but entirely typical, that the implicit attack on NUSAS, which the founding of SASO involved, never led to a breach of the good personal relationships he continued to enjoy with the white NUSAS leaders. This document is not only an excellent account of the reasons for the founding of SASO and a stout defense of its non-racialist intentions, it is also a good example of that combination of tough, even aggressive language with a basically friendly underlying spirit, which was so marked a feature always of Steve's statesmanlike approach to other organizations and persons. As an interesting follow-up to this chapter, Chapter 4 is a report by Steve on his presidential tour of most of the black campuses, which was published in the June 1970 issue of the SASO newsletter, i.e. 4 months after the letter to the SRC presidents. Steve spent a great part of his presidential year touring the campuses and building up support for the young movement. 2. SRC Presidents, English and Afrikaans Medium Universities, National Student Organizations, Other Organizations, Overseas Organizations. Dear Sir, RE, South African Students Organization. Allow us at this stage to introduce the South African Students Organization to you. This is a one-year-old organization which was established at the inaugural conference at the University of the North in July 1969. This circular is meant to give your organization a true and first-hand account of the factors that led to the establishment of the organization. We also intend giving you a clear picture of where we stand today in relation to the other student organizations in the country. Historical background. The implementation in 1960 of the Fort Hare Transfer Act of 1959, which brought Fort Hare under direct government control, dealt a blow to student contact between the university and the rest of the student population. The dissolution of the SRC at Fort Hare in August that year by the students themselves was a sequel to the stringent measures applied at this then only black university to suppress the freedom of the students to meet and discuss with whomsoever they wanted to. Even more contained were the sister universities that were established that same year, i.e., University College of the Western Cape for coloreds, University College of Zululand for Zulus, University College of the North for Sothos, University College of Durban for Indians. The concept of an independent SRC was never known at these places. The rector had virtually limitless powers of veto over anything the students decided to do. This power of veto was especially applied to all moves by students to associate with NUSAS. Hence, the long period of isolation started. The establishment of the University Christian Movement in 1967 opened new avenues for contact. UCM had a special appeal to students at the university colleges. The fact that within a year and a half of its existence, the UCM had already a black majority in its sessions is indicative of this. Hence, with the continued getting together of students from the university colleges, dialogue began again amongst black students. One of the most talked about topics was the position of the black students in the open organizations like NUSAS and UCM. Concern was expressed that these were white dominated and paid very little attention to problems peculiar to the black community. In fact, some people began to question the very competence of pluralistic groups to examine without bias problems affecting one group, especially if the unaffected group is from the oppressor camp. It was felt that a time had come when blacks had to formulate their own thinking, unpolluted by ideas emanating from a group with lots at stake in the status quo. There was nothing new in this kind of thinking. In bodies like African Students Association and African Students Union of South Africa, founded between 1960 and 1961, in the older black campuses, essentially the same underlying thinking was embodied. However, these organizations died off for various reasons. The Durban Students Union also came and went. The problem remained unsolved. Some people amongst the black communities felt that the best approach would be a black takeover of the quote-unquote open student organizations engineered from within. However, this idea never got any real support, since to start with, black students at the university colleges were not even allowed to participate freely in these organizations. In the NUSAS conference of 1967, the blacks were made to stay at a church building somewhere in the Grahamstown location, each day being brought to conference site by cars, etc. On the other hand, their white brothers were staying in residence around the conference site. This is perhaps the turning point in the history of black support for NUSAS. So appalling were the conditions that it showed the blacks just how valued they were in the organization. The 1968 NUSAS Congress was uneventful. The overriding impression was that the blacks were there in name only. The swing to the right in the organization did not meet with the usual counter from the blacks. It was clear that none of the blacks felt a part of the organization. Hence, the executive that was elected was all white. Shortly thereafter, still in July, black students at a UCM conference demanded time to meet alone as a group. Ostensibly, they were to discuss what to do in the face of the quote-unquote 72-hour clause, which forbade them to remain in a white area for more than 72 hours at a time. However, once together, they discussed, for the first time, formally the idea of forming a black organization. They had to choose between a structured and non-structured alliance, and they decided on the former for the sake of continuity. The problem was that none of them were student leaders, and therefore they could not take binding decisions. In December 1968, a conference of SRCs from the black campuses decided overwhelmingly in favor of a black organization, and in July 1969, at the inaugural conference of SASO, the organization was formally founded. It might probably be untrue to give the impression that everything was smooth. However, most of the debate arose because of the tendency not to want to do what appears to conform with government policy, i.e., to segregate against another group. To quote from the SASO communique released in July 1969. 1. At a time when events are moving so fast in the country, it is not totally advisable to show any form of division amongst students' ranks, especially now that students appear to be a power to be reckoned with in this country. 2. Any move that tends to divide the student population into separate lagers on the basis of color is in a way a tacit submission to having been defeated and apparently seems in agreement with apartheid. 3. In a racially sensitive country like ours, provision for racially exclusive bodies tends to build up resentment and to widen the gap that exists between the races, and the student community should resist all attempts to fall into this temptation. 4. Any formation of a purely non-white body shall be subject to a lot of scrutiny, and so the chances of the organization's lasting are very little. This shows in a nutshell just how strong the doubts were amongst some black student leaders. However, the argument to go ahead was much stronger. While, as a matter of principle, we would reject separation in a normal society, we have to take cognizance of the fact that ours is far from a normal society. It is difficult not to look at white society as a group of people bent on perpetuating the status quo. The situation is not made easier by the non-acceptance that black students have met with in all the so-called open organizations, both religious and secular. All suffer from the same fault, basically, of accepting as a fact that there shall be white leadership, and even worse, that they shall occupy themselves predominantly with problems affecting white society first. Another important point was that in the interest of preserving a farcical non-racial front, almost 80% of the black students were regarded as expendable. These are the students who, for instance, were not allowed to participate freely in organizations like NUSAS because they were at government-controlled university colleges. To quote once more from the SASO communique, in choosing to meet on a limited scale rather than not meeting at all, the non-white students shall be choosing the lesser evil and striving to offset some of the evils that have accrued from the same evil system that made it impossible for them to meet freely with other students. Structure. In terms of structure, SASO operates like a national union, although she does not claim to be one. The basic type of affiliation is, quote-unquote, center affiliation. The SRCs are the power bases. They affiliate on behalf of their students. Where there is no SRC, we accept a majority student body decision as an automatic affiliation by that center. Individual membership is also catered for. The governing body of SASO is the General Students' Council, which meets once a year. It consists of the delegates from the various centers and branches, and also the executive. This is the official policy-making body of SASO. The executive governs in between GSC sessions, working according to mandates given to it by the GSC, or General Student Council. The president is the sole interpreter of policy in between sessions. Policy. SASO has thus far taken policy only on a few topics, these mainly being student organization, our broad basis of operation, etc. A. NUSAS. 1. SASO recognizes NUSAS as the true national union of students in South Africa today. This is based on the paper policy of the organization. We offer no competition to NUSAS for black membership. 2. SASO criticizes the dichotomy between principle and practice found in the organization. We reject their basis of integration as being based on standards predominantly set by white society. It is more of what the white man expects the black man to do than the other way around. We feel we do not have to prove ourselves to anybody. 3. The fact that there are 27,000 white students and 3,000 black students in the organization is not complementary to black opinion being fairly listened to. 4. The commitment of white students to the principles of the organization is limited to very few individuals, and hence NUSAS credentials as a sincere and committed aspirant for change are wanting. B. ASB. This is the Afrikaans Studentbond, a culturally inclined organization operating predominantly at the Afrikaans medium universities. It lays stress on Calvinism and Afrikanerdom as criteria for membership. 1. We uphold the right of any group to want to perpetuate their culture via this sort of organization. 2. Where this promotion of a group culture implies cultivation of racist tendencies, then the quote-unquote right becomes a negative right, like the right to kill. 3. We tend to dismiss ASB as an incorrigible group with whom no worthwhile contact can be maintained. C. UCM. The University Christian Movement is a religious group concerning itself with ecumenical topics and modernization of the archaic Christian religious practice. It also concerns itself with a practical application of Christian principles in an immoral society like the South African one. 1. We believe to a great extent that UCM has overcome the problems of adjustment to a two-tier society like ours. However, we still feel that the fact that the blacks are in the majority in the organization has not been sufficiently evidenced in the direction of thought and in the leadership of the organization. 2. We nevertheless feel that UCM's progress is commendable, especially in the direction of provoking meaningful thinking amongst clergymen and its members. D. The press. SASO rejects the press and believes in having as little to do with it as possible. The press is largely directed at white society or the so-called electorate whose values are laced with racial prejudice against black people. Equally, SASO rejects the black press, which up to now has been largely controlled and some of it financed by government institutions. We believe that, alongside Radio Bantu, most of the black press is being used as instruments of propaganda to get people to swallow most of the unbalanced and inflated stories about, quote-unquote, what the government is doing for the Bantus, or for the Indians, or for the colors. Aims. The aims of SASO are concerned primarily with black students, and also with contact amongst students in general. Put in a paraphrased form, these are: 1. To crystallize the needs and aspirations of the non-white students and to seek to make known their grievances. 2. Where possible, to put into effect programs designed to meet the needs of the non-white students and to act on a collective basis in an effort to solve some of the problems which beset the centers individually. 3. To heighten the degree of contact, not only amongst the non-white, but also amongst these and the rest of the South African student population, to make the non-white students accepted on their own terms as an integral part of the South African community. 4. To establish a solid identity amongst the non-white students and to ensure that these students are always treated with the dignity and respect they deserve. 5. To protect the interests of the member centers and to act as a pressure group on all institutions and organizations for the benefit of the non-white students. 6. To boost up the morale of the non-white student, to heighten their own confidence in themselves, and to contribute largely to the direction of thought taken by the various institutions on social, political, and other current topics. While these aims might appear to be couched in racialistic language, they are in fact a sign that the black student community has at last lost faith with their white counterparts and is now withdrawing from the open society. The blacks are tired of standing at the touchlines to witness a game that they should be playing. They want to do things for themselves and all by themselves. Conclusion. Too much caution has had to be taken at the beginning, and the progress has been slow. We have reached a stage now where our existence has become an accomplished fact, and our way of seeing things has been adopted by a substantial number on the black campuses. Our limited dialogue with NUSAS, which has been along lines of constructive criticism, has been interpreted deliberately by some groups, including officials of ASB, as a rejection of non-racialism as a political goal. Yet, while critics to the right of NUSAS might rejoice, one thing they have to keep in mind is that with all its shortcomings, NUSAS is still worth talking to. It is, on the other hand, we believe, a painful waste of time to engage in any dialogue with racially bigoted organizations like the ASB. Hence, some people at the last SASO conference felt that this organization, quote-unquote, should be left alone to their small world of isolation, whose boundaries are the four wheels of an Osewa. Footnote. A wagon. End of footnote. SASO adopts the principle that blacks should work themselves into a powerful group so as to go forth and stake their rightful claim in the open society, rather than to exercise the power in some obscure part of the Kalahari. Hence, this belies the belief that our withdrawal is an end in itself. Steve Biko, President. Chapter 4, Black Campuses and Current Feelings. The article that follows below is a brief summary of observations I made during the tour of most of the black campuses. It is based on discussions at student body meetings, SRC meetings, and with small groups of individuals outside local leadership circles. Slowly at first, and quite fast of late, the black student community is casting aside the old approach toward solving its problems. A definite spirit of independence and an awareness of ourselves as a group with potential strength is beginning to manifest itself in many ways. On many an occasion, I found the various campuses not only ready to support but also eager to join in directing the thinking of Sasso. It was generally agreed that at this stage of our history, the most logical step is to follow the directive given by Sasso, i.e., that of concentrating on ourselves as a group and amalgamating our forces. One striking feature is the steep decline in the intensity of the quote-unquote morality argument. Some time ago, quite a lot of people used to be violently opposed to segregation, even when practiced by blacks against whites. Of late, people of this persuasion are beginning to see the logic of rejecting the so-called bilateral approach. The idea that blacks and whites can participate as equal partners in an open organization is being questioned, even by the most ardent black supporters of non-racialism. These people realize now that a lot of time and strength is wasted in maintaining artificial and token non-racialism at student level. Artificial not in the sense that it is natural to segregate, but rather because even those involved in it have certain prejudices that they cannot get rid of and are therefore basically dishonest to themselves, to their black counterparts, and to the community of black people who are called upon to have faith in such people. Another noticeable feature is that most of the students, while very sure of what they did not like in it, and who were quite harsh in their criticism of the old approach, yet lacked a depth of insight into what can be done. One found, wherever he went, the question being asked repeatedly, quote-unquote, "Where do we go from here?" This again is a tragic result of the old approach, where the blacks were made to fit into a pattern largely and often wholly determined by white students. Hence, our originality and imagination have been dulled to the point where it takes a supreme effort to act logically, even in order to follow one's beliefs and convictions. A third and also important observation was the eagerness of the students to wish to relate whatever is done to their situation in the community. There is growing awareness of the role the black students may be called upon to play in the emancipation of their community. The students realize that the isolation of the black intelligentsia from the rest of the black society is a disadvantage to black people as a whole. When everything is said and done, one must express pleasant surprise at the quality of leadership on the various campuses. The history of most of the black campuses is marred with restrictions and intimidations. One would have thought that by now everybody has been cowed down to the point of dogged acceptance of all that comes from authority. Yet, at many places I was surprised by the sheer bargaining power that the SRCs have built with their respective authorities. Strong delegations are being sent from most of the black campuses to the SASO conference, where a concentrated effort will be made to get answers to some of the questions. The conference promises to be both interesting and enlightening, especially in view of the diversity that one finds in approach. But some things are common to all: to bear witness to the unity of the black students, to give proper direction and depth to the movement, and to make themselves worthy of the claim that they are the leaders of tomorrow. Steve Biko.